Okay, we can begin. Just to talk about this afternoon and the conduct of the meeting, you'll notice we've got video cameras here, so the meeting is being videoed. The meeting is being videoed, and we intend to make sure then that members of the public can have access to that so they can see how we've made the decisions on the future adaptations of the Friarage. So, welcome everybody. We're going to do a round of introductions again, that's to help with people who may want to view the video at a later date. You'll have some microphones in front of you, and there's a button. If you push, the light will come on, and if you could speak when the light's on, and you can switch it between the two of you. So we'll go around. I'm Henry Crone, the late chairman of the CCG.
Vicky Plaidell, clinical chief officer at the CCG.
Sarah Ferguson,
senior delivery manager
of Hambleton,
Richmondshire,
Whitby CCG. Charles Parker, GP in Topliff.
Duncan Rogers, GP, Northallerton,
Mervyn House. Andrew Trenchard, GP in Thirsk.
Lynn Owen, practice manager, Central Bills practice at Hawes and Ayrshire.
Peter Chris, practice manager, Mayford House Surgery, Northallerton.
Laura Mazos, GP, partner, Beedale Surgery.
Stephen Brown, managing partner, Leyburn.
Mark Hodgson, GP, Aldbrough St John.
Mark Dougalby, GP in Stokesley.
Dylan Owen, GP in Leyburn.
Ian Suffling, GP in Slights at Sandsend.
Sam Cockgrave, head of nursing and governance for Defence Primary Healthcare in North England.
Judith Bromfield, representing Health Watch North Yorkshire.
Jane Ritchie, the Lay representative for Richmondshire.
Linda Lloyd, the Lay representative for the Whitby area.
Can you just introduce yourself, Siobhan?
Yes, sorry, I'm late. Siobhan Watch, she's here with medical practice. Oh, sorry. Siobhan Watt, Harewood Medical Practice GP.
Thank you. We have apologies from the following, I'll go through. We've got apologies from Whitby Group Practice, Staines, Acton, Lambert, Great Eaton, Reith, Quakers Lane, Catterick, Friary, sorry, Mr. Danley. No apologies. Thank you.
Okay, I first of all just wanted to explain a little bit about the background, about why the meeting is set up the way that it is. And I think when we were looking at the governance of making a decision as big as this, we felt we needed to have a look through the regulations. As you know, the governing body is a meeting that is held in public. But the council members is a private meeting, and that's in our constitution, which is a nationally agreed framework for how CCGs work. But since the GPs decided that they needed to make this decision, we felt we had to find a way of being able to make this more accessible to the public than it was, because we have done everything about this piece of work, and actually about the way that we work, in as public facing a way as possible. So therefore, what we decided the best thing to do would be to invite the people on the governing body who are our lay representatives, and also to ask Health Watch to come and then to video this, so that any of members of the public who wish to see the debate can watch this on a YouTube video. And I think that we need, as a council members, probably at some point in the future, need to think that if we're going to be making more serious decisions and big decisions that involve the public, then we may need to reconsider how we conduct this meeting. And it might be that future meetings might need to be in public. But to do that, we actually need to reconsider the constitution. I wonder whether it's just useful also to introduce the people who are sat behind there, just so we know who they are. I think we sort of missed them out, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
Yeah, hi, I'm Julie Wilson. I'm the Assistant Director for Clinical Strategy from the North Yorkshire Rural Area team
of NHS England. I'm Ken Reachaw. I'm a member of the governing body responsible for audit and governance.
I'm Marshall, Communications Manager for the CCG.
I'm Justine Hart, Temporary Communications Officer with the CSU.
Shirley Moses, project lead for the Friarage from CCG.
The people who are not here, the practices who are not represented, have given us feedback, so we do have their votes, although they weren't able to come. So their participation in the process is still there, And when we go through the voting process, we will the votes for those practices are already up there, so they will add to this. I think the next thing just to say is a little bit about the process since the end of the consultation. I'm sure that's already in the documentation, but just to go over it, we received three new options from two members of the public and Richmondshire District Council, and that went out to you. And what we did was we then had a meeting with those people who had written the proposals and the clinicians from the hospital to talk through the viability of those. The transcripts of those meetings are available on our website. And the outcome of that was in the pack that we sent to you. I think that we then decided what we needed to use was exactly the same process that we did for the engagement process when we came up with the options to go to consultation. The first part of that was about filtering out those options that did not meet minimum standards. And the minimum standards were the minimum safety requirements and the sustainability of the options. When we went through them, and with the feedback we also got from MCAT, none of the new options appeared to fulfil those criteria. And before we go on to any further thing, I think it's important for us to discuss as a group whether the practices agree with that view that we came up with as a CCG executive. So I think I'd open it to the floor for your views about those three options.
Well, certainly from our practice when we discussed it earlier in the week, there was a feeling that an NCAP hadn't felt that it was clinically safe to proceed. We didn't think that it was a starter.
I think it would be true to say that I think one of the things for us, and I think it became very clear as we had the discussions with the clinicians, was that all of the options from Richmondshire District Council were based around having a different middle tier. So using a different way of providing the middle tier of medical cover. And actually, all the visits that they've done to other places have been about having a mixed middle tier, usually made up of a combination of non-training doctors, research doctors, and extended scope nurses. So what we did was we wrote to the deanery, first of all, to say, is there any chance that there'll be extra training doctors available for the Friarage? And basically, they said, couldn't ever say never, but it would only ever be one or two, and then not in a very predictable way. So we felt that was a sort of no-go. And we had that letter, which will be part of what goes in the documentation. We then talked to all the other places that Richmondshire District Council had visited. And what they all said was that they had grown these nurse practitioners from scratch. There is no national training programme, there are no nationally agreed standards. So these are people you actually have to train through a process. And that those arrangements were very fragile. And also that they knew that with the standards from the Royal Colleges, that they were only ever going to be a temporary fix. So they may keep the service going for a time, but only a time. And at some point, you would actually need to have a full standard, which would mean a fully medical team. So the challenge to us is that we don't have that option here. As a commissioner, if South Tees 7 years ago had decided that their way forward was to create a different middle tier, we might be in a different place now. Not that that would be a long-term solution, but it might have kept things going for 3-4 more years. But they didn't. I mean, their investment, and actually their advice from their PCT at the time, was to invest in an extra consultant. That's where the money went, not in putting in a lot of extra nurses. So we don't have an extra tier of nurses, and you can't buy them. So actually, as a CCG, we're sort of stuck. You know, there isn't another model. And And I think the other very useful thing is we had a letter from the north of Scotland, which is one of the areas that John went to say, you know, you've managed to do it there, how did you do it? And their response to us is we're about to embark on a consultation about our concerns about safety and sustainability of the paediatric service in Scotland. And it will probably not look like it does now in 5 years' time. So what we feel is that what that's put us is at the beginning of a group of people, and I think we're at the front. There are lots of people behind us who are actually watching very closely what we're doing. Richmondshire District Council also recently been to Furness to look at the model there, and their CCG, that's Cumbria, have committed to maintaining that service. Cumbria CCG came about 2 or 3 months ago to see us as a CCG and asked us about the process we've been through. And when we looked at the information, what we actually found was the geography is different. The geography for Cumbria would be us without Darlington or Scarborough. One hospital, no other option. And what we feel is that if Darlington wasn't there, then we would be in a very different position as a CCG. But Darlington is there, and as an option, it does give us a way of sustaining services here that are near enough. So what we felt was, looking at all of that, we didn't have within the Richmondshire District Council's options a way forward that was safe and sustainable. And that if we, in a way, done all this work, what we absolutely need to stick with is that it needs to be a model that will be sustainable into the future.
Yeah. Discussing we had in our practice, I think the only real alternative to the two options was the Richmondshire Council option. The other two options, the nurse-led with SHA support, there were distinct worries about the safety of that one and being worse off than where we were now. And the other option was really things we could do to improve options one and two rather than a solution in itself. Mm-hmm. And I didn't think that actually took us to a place we could run a service from that delivery. There were serious concerns about the Richmondshire Council offer about the costs and how realistic those costs were and whether £200,000 would actually pay for all the extra things on top of, and that was the basis for our worries about the sustainability of the Richmondshire Council suggestion.
I thought what we thought was quite interesting about it was. The other thing that was quite interesting about it was the other thing that was quite interesting about that particular piece of work was the shift of work from Middlesbrough to here. And there was a feeling, well, actually there might be a possibility for some shift of work, even with, if it did go down a midwifery-led unit, because there are areas around Middlesbrough where it might be feasible to transfer patients over. So that was quite an interesting thought.
We have some feedback from South East CCG, who obviously the CCG whose patients would potentially come, and what they said was they think it's really important that their patients are offered choice, but there could not be anything more than that, an explanation of choice. And the other thing is there is a midwifery-led unit at James Cook that is co-located with the consultant-led unit, which is very nice and friendly, and so it may be that many patients still would choose to go there, but there certainly will be no way that we could guarantee a transfer of patients to the Friarage. But I agree, and certainly I think one of the things that the midwifery service has realised is that they need to offer choice more explicitly. One of the feedbacks we got from patients in Colburn was they didn't know that they could go up to Darlington now. Because they're actually never explicitly offered that choice. So I think there's something about how the midwifery teams offer more explicit choice.
Can I just add, I chaired the meetings with the people who made the proposals, and I think it's worth saying that we actually tried to take positive bits of their proposals. So there was about enhancing community services, enhancing the role of GPs going forward, better training. The issue about transport, so I think it's worth noting that you know, we have looked at each of those options with a view to try to take the good ideas out of those options to go forward, and I think we've done that. I think the thing that struck me about the Richmondshire Council, as a lay person, so to speak, is one of the authors of that report said to us in the meeting, we should just ignore the Royal College recommendations. I think as a responsible commissioning body, that's not something we would do. So I think it was saying, you know, obviously if there's merit to some of the proposals, we'll look at them, but I think we can't just ignore the Royal College recommendations in relation to delivering safe and quality services. So I think that was something that struck me about the proposal for which we spoke about. So just need to note.
Can I just ask you whether your practices were comfortable then not to formally score any of the other three proposals that came in because they didn't meet the minimum standards?
So yes, we just have a show of hands to formally record that. It's a unanimous.
So the next thing that we'll ask you formally is that, you know, I think last time we went through a process where we developed some decision-making criteria. Although the CCG has actually For the general work, we've moved to a slightly different set of criteria. We felt it was appropriate to use the same criteria that we used previously for this, to go through the same process that we did for the engagement phase. Mm-hmm. So are you comfortable as a... Nigel, can you come and sit at the table? Sorry. Nigel, can you just introduce yourself for the process?
Press the button. Nigel Leaney-Bolson, GP from Sport and Medical Center.
Nigel, we've just gone through the first three options, the three new options, and we wondered if you had any questions about them before we go on to the next part of the meeting. Okay. So I think the next thing is just to go through the scoring, really, isn't it? If you're happy with the criteria that we used, is everyone happy with the criteria that we used for the scoring? Can we have a show of hands around that? Nigel? Sorry. Thank you. We've had a vote that you missed, which was that whether or not you were happy with the using the minimum criteria not to get you all to vote on the three extra options.
Yes, I'm happy.
Vicky, could I ask you, you are we going to be discussing the questions around those options as well? There were some question sheets that you sent out.
Yep.
To expand on what those options might develop into.
Yeah, so they're just here. So
right.
Yeah, so we've just put those questions up on the screen.
Okay, so we're now going to look at the two options that we scored, and I think we'll just go through the questions. I think the first one was about the working hours of the short stay assessment unit for option one. There's been a lot of backwards and forwards with the trust around this. Around 7-day working, 5-day working, their view is that to have a 7-day short stay assessment unit creates a lot of problems for them operationally. And the reason behind that is that the only way that the short stay assessment unit is cost effective is if it runs alongside outpatients, because the number of children coming through the unit will be very small. So the consultants who are there need to be doing outpatient work and then see children who come to the short stay assessment unit in between. The hospital is not set up yet for 7-day a week outpatients. because it doesn't have the right configuration for pathology or x-ray or any of those things. They don't have 7-day working for those departments. They have emergency working on the weekend. So I suppose what we're, as a CCG, thinking about, and it's for you to decide this, the extra cost of 7-day working would be a lot, because we'd be paying for consultants to see a very few number of patients. And I suppose our original thinking was that we would commit as a CCG to develop 7-day working as the NHS moves towards 7 days and more 7-day outpatient starts at the Friarage to deliver 7-day outpatients for everybody. And that as that happens, then adding on the short stay assessment unit would be financially viable, whereas doing it now would actually just be paying for consultants to be there on call, seeing potentially 2 or 3 children every day. But I'm happy to take your views about that.
Can I just make a comment that we felt in our practice, and I don't know whether anybody else felt the same, but using the exclusion criteria as to which choices we should actually consider, we felt that option 2 didn't meet those criteria. So we didn't score option 2 at all, because care closer to home, we felt that if you didn't have the day unit, that it didn't meet that criterion. I don't know whether anybody else felt the same as that.
Yeah, at Central Dales we didn't score option 2 either. I suppose we scored it, but we're in the more privileged position of being that bit nearer to Darlington, and we were actually scoring it for our patients and felt that we were representing our practice. One thing we couldn't quite understand is that obviously children get sick every day of the week, and we wondered whether the less workload at the weekends is because out of hours are already directing children to Darlington or not. I don't know. But it did seem unusual. The feeling was that children get sick any day of the week and need access to acute services. Mm.
I think what the Trust would say is that if you look at the experience, there are fewer admissions at the weekend, but it's not so much that. It's mainly that in terms of workforce, they will be doing 2 jobs during the week and 1 job at the weekend, which is where the problem starts. And that's not from an access for children's point of view, it's from an operational point of view from the Trust. Now, we could, and we have costs for a 7-day service.
It's an additional 266,000.
So to have the weekend service would cost us an extra £266,000. Now, we can agree to do that if that is what you as a council of the members think is the right thing to do.
That's an extra cost, but on the basis there's a reduction in staffing costs associated with reducing it down. So is that cost worked out on the reduction basis as a total cost or what the new cost?
It's all done through, I mean they've worked it all through. It's a cost above tariff, that's what we looked at, because we will go on paying tariff for every child that goes into hospital, and we're negotiating the tariffs with them at the moment. So this is what they think it would cost above tariff.
We felt it was important that the service was the same every day of the week. A Monday to Friday service, people knock off early on the Friday afternoon and it doesn't work the same. It should be the same every day, accepting that things would then cost more at the weekends. Services could be changed so that reviews were done at the weekends. There are still going to be children who need open access services that could still use it at the weekends. And I suspect that we will start to practice in a different way. My colleagues who work in out of hours, and I don't think there's anybody here that works in Northallerton out of hours very much, certainly wanted the service over the weekend as well. But they didn't want to feel they had to send any child to James Cook at the weekend. And I think if the service was available, they would use it. Basing on historical activity probably isn't right, because people will practice differently because the service is different.
We as a practice quite strongly felt that the opening hours 9 to 5 was not appropriate to be extended. It's not uncommon to see the ill children later on in the day.
I think the discussions have actually moved on since we did this. I mean, I think what they've now said is it'd be at least 9 till 9. What I've asked them to do is to give us the figures for admissions right now, because 9 till 9 feels a bit like we'd rather it go 10 to 10, because looking at how general practice works, actually, by the time you're seeing poorly children, 9 o'clock feels a bit early to have it open, whereas 10 o'clock feels perhaps a better time. So I think it may well be 10 to 10. We've asked them to look at what that would mean for them. But I think that what we need from you is if you feel that should be 7 days a week, and that's and we should vote on that, because that would be something that the CCG will need to look at. I mean, it's extra money, and that would then go alongside the other, you know, things that we have to fund going forward this year. The other thing to say is that we are hopefully, and part of this was also to put in a 7 day a week community paediatric service, and we felt that that would particularly support those children with open access. Because when you look at what they come into hospital for, a lot of those things could be delivered at home by senior nurses. IVs, problems with their bowels, those are the kind of things they come into hospital for at the weekend. And actually, we think we could deliver that service at home. There's a lot of services even now, even during the week, that actually those children come into hospital for. And if you talk to the consultants, what they have said to us is that they have developed a sort of primary care for children with complex needs, which they've done because they've been relatively quiet. And actually what they really need to do is step that back and allow those children to access their primary care for those things and do slightly less. So it's about then, if we supported the community system, that would then allow them to have those things at home, which for many of them is a much less traumatic thing than coming into hospital.
Do you have to with the new service development, whatever format it takes, does it have to be finely tuned at the onset, or could you have like a 3 or 6 month period where you're doing additional weekend work and then review it if it's not cost effective, or if there is a general drift anyway?
Absolutely.
We felt the same as that, whether you have a 6 month trial and see whether the need was there, or have a 6 month trial with it in and then review it. We thought that was maybe where it's happening.
Yeah. I think it's important to state that that's what we've said with the community ambulance service, the community paramedics.
Okay. Other practices about 7 days?
I think that we felt as a practice that the extra expense wasn't justified for so few patients. The money could probably be spent better on community services and things like that. So we just went to the 9 till 9 weekday.
We saw things in that perspective too.
That's what we thought as well.
I think we felt for our patients was where we're geographically based, closer to the South Tees anyway, that wouldn't be a problem for ours. But I can see the patients who live around the Northallerton area, it would be more tricky weekends.
You
need
a vote?
So
the first vote will be on a 7 day service rather than a 5 day service. So around the table for the 7 day service.
Can I just interrupt there? I think we were in favour of that, but especially if it can be sort of done on a trial and error situation for, say, 6 months or so.
Okay, so
7 day service for 6 months. 7 day service for 6 months. Okay, for those in favour of a 7 day service for a trial period of 6 months? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9, yes. That means there's two against. Okay.
Three no's.
Three no's.
Three no's.
Oh, sorry. Yes. Three no's. Okay.
Okay. I should just give you a sort of up-to-date version about the ambulance. When we talked to the ambulance service about putting on an extra ambulance, we actually then began to look at the activity of that ambulance. And if you sort of take average figures for the number of people we would expect to use the midwifery led unit, and then the number who get into trouble, we were looking at transferring 2 patients a week, approximately. And the cost of the ambulance service is considerable. And yet, I think everyone felt that was the right thing to do, certainly initially for the first 6 months. But as part of another piece of work we're doing called the Better Care Fund, we've been trialling in parts of the CCG having community paramedics working in practice, and they've been very successful. And I think those practices that have them like them very much and find that they're a great resource to the practice, and they've reduced emergency ambulance call outs. So it struck us that since one of the areas that we talked about having one was in Northallerton, that rather than have these paramedics sitting about for all but two calls a week, it would be good to put them in a practice and allow them to be paramedic, community paramedics in the practice during the day, and then ask them to work either without of hours or with A&E or both out of hours, so that they would basically be working in A&E stroke out of hours and supporting those services. So although it looks like quite a big cost, it would actually span two projects for us. And would it also help reduce ambulance response times, which is something that we need to be working at to improve. So we felt actually it was quite a positive step forward and will affect people more widely than just those who need to be transferred. The point of having them working in a practice rather than going out on ambulance calls is that when they need to go, they would leave that person in a place of safety rather than at home. They'd leave them in the practice or at A&E, so that they could respond, therefore, immediately to the call from the hospital to transfer the patient.
Could you just explain that, Vicky? Because with our paramedic, they don't actually transport patients.
No, I know.
So you'd have two people based in a surgery in Northallerton with a
proper ambulance.
Equipped
on. With a proper ambulance, yeah. And so the costs are slightly higher, but actually what we looked at was the proposal we got from the ambulance service about the community paramedic, and then the proposal we got for them for the 24/7 for the maternity, and actually not a lot of tweaking that you to change one to the other. You'd have to have a slightly, rather than the original proposal was for two band five paramedics, and to turn it into a community responder it would need a six and a three, and the combination of that meant actually that the saving was not very much. The other thing is that this would work 7 days a week, which is more than what you have in the community paramedics, and it would enhance the out of hours, which we were already talking about trying to make a more integrated out of hours at the Friarage, so it would support that work.
Did you say that they would be responding to 999 calls as well to reduce the number of calls?
We're looking at that. I mean, the difficulty with that is that obviously we need to make sure that it doesn't go very far. So it may be that they would respond to red ones and red twos, but only in Northallerton. Mm-hmm. And they would only do that if there was another crew that were near enough by to have a standby so they could still get to the Friarage within 8 minutes if there was a call for maternity. So they would do some, but not all.
Sorry, I'm just a little bit confused here. Did you make the assumption that we all voted in favour of this dedicated ambulance at 230 per annum?
No.
No.
We're just trying to put a proposal together said that this is a way of doing it.
Yeah.
I think what people need to understand is there's a lot of anxiety from the public around this. And the point of putting that ambulance in, and we originally going to do it for 6 months, was to be able to monitor the ambulance use and see whether we needed it long term. Because the problem is that the biggest response we got from the public was anxiety about transfer for people who... And actually, if you look at what's happening in Bishop Auckland, they've closed their midwifery-led unit because of anxieties about being able to guarantee transfer times for women when their risk status increases. So that's where that's come from. It's a lot of money, I agree, but perhaps we have two-stage decision, don't we? Are you in favour of the extra ambulance, and then are you in favour of the paramedic bit?
It mentions emergency transfer there, but what about the more routine transfer of a child that can't be discharged home but isn't necessarily an emergency?
Yep.
How is that going to happen?
The evidence is that would be probably one or two transfers a day, and the ambulance service are confident that they can do that within the contract they have now.
Within our practice, when we were talking about this, Vicky, we felt that actually, if it's an emergency, the ambulances should be able to deal with that. You know, if it's only twice a week, we didn't feel it should need a dedicated, but it should be an emergency, and that there should be availability.
We were the same. We were the same.
I suppose what the ambulance will say to you in response to that is this is extra and it's beyond what they were contracted to provide now because it's an extra service. And that they are worried that if they did it within the initial, with the contract they already have, that they would not be able to do it. I mean, I think ambulance services is a moving feast. A lot of the work we've done as a CCG has really improved ambulance times already, particularly with the community responders, the fact that they're bringing patients to you now, the phone 999. I mean, our ambulance responders have improved hugely in our area for the first time in living memory. And I think that's praise to you for participating in those. And I think, you know, if you don't want to do that, then that is what we will take to the public. My only response to you is I think the public would be worried about that, which is why we put the proposal in.
I suppose one of the thoughts about how, from our own experience with paramedics, is that if you've got an ambulance tied up to GP surgery, going out for issues linked, you know, within that area, it's not actually using the paramedics as we're using them at the moment, because they're going out really to, if you like, triage and assess situations to see whether you then need an ambulance. Whereas you're going to have an ambulance tied up, not necessarily appropriately, with urgent calls.
I suppose we were just trying to do something that meant we didn't have people sat about. And that's the point of trying to put the two proposals together, that otherwise we're going to have a paramedic crew of two band fives sat on their bottoms in Northallerton 24 hours a day to do two calls a week. So it was just, could we do something that actually allowed us creatively to use those people rather than having them not? And it may be that the right thing to do actually is to put them in A&E, where they're right actually at the hospital, where they have a clinical role in A&E, and not use them as a community paramedic. I'd much rather do that than have them sat in the ambulance station, which feels like a very kind of negative to, you know, sort of pointless thing to do, really.
Although this isn't part of the discussion, we do have a problem with patients attending accidents and emergencies for minor ailments at the two Northallerton practices, and if this could help that side of the equation as well, that would be beneficial. We, as a practice, voted no against spending £230,000 solely for those two transfers a week. But I think if this was taken on expanding it to a more inclusive role, then we would say yes.
Yeah, we'd be the same.
If there's no further comments, we'll take a vote on this issue. So the proposal is to have a dedicated service, but to link it to another service, either in a practice or in a hospital, is that what you're saying? So the vote is having a dedicated service, but linking it to another function within the Northallerton locality, whether it's a baby or a minor injuries or a practice. So can people give us a vote on that? Okay, that's carried. Everybody, yes.
So I'm voting here, but we didn't 12. Specifically discuss that as a practice, so this is my best guess.
Okay. So it's 12 for one against. I would add to just, in the public means, in the public means, it has been a real issue that's come up quite a lot, about the anxiety of transfer, so I think.
Can I just ask you to vote for the ambulance doing the maternity alone? Just so we have that recorded too.
So the second vote is just for an ambulance, dedicated ambulance, which will deal just with the maternity side of the service. One, two, three.
Three.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. The next bit is the shuttle bus. And again, this is very much part of the feedback we got from the public, a concern about being able to get up to James Cook. Particularly, I think, from people like mothers who have children in special care, who may be there for quite a long time, the constant driving up and down the A19, and the idea that if they had a shuttle bus, this would help them. And to be fair, this is not just feedback we've got around this particular issue, but generally from the public about the number of outpatient appointments they go to at James Cook. And so we feel that by doing this, we would actually be supporting not just young people with maternity and paediatrics, but actually the community about driving up and down the A19. Many places around the country who have the kind of arrangement that we have with a small BDH and a larger centre have this kind of arrangement. Again, we wouldn't suggest this was long term. We will put this in as a trial for 6 months to see how it's used. And again, we are working with South Tees Trust to share the costs, because my view is that this also supports them and that they need to be a partner in this. And we've made many discussions with them about that, and they are still considering it. What they're looking at is, could they use the bus to transport other things? If they had a safe box in there to put bloods and things, they could also use that. And they also need to take advice about whether that's considered safe. So they're just those issues that they need to sort out.
We'd said no because we said you don't have that for any of the specialties, but you're saying that it would be for the specialties because that wasn't clear from here. We thought it was just for paediatrics and maternity, so we said no for that one.
Yeah. Likewise at Labour, I think that would change our vote because originally we said no. Is that the point that Lynn's made there?
Sorry. I'm sorry if I didn't make that clear. That's our fault, because actually we were talking about shuttle bus would be for everybody and free, and it was going to be 5 journeys a day at no cost to the public, because they will have to pay for parking at the Friarage, so we feel they're already paying for that.
We felt the same. It hasn't happened for other specialties like trauma and orthopaedics or stroke or what have you. If it was going to be done, it should be maybe done as a separate initiative outside of this, but now is an opportune time to talk about it.
I think South Tees Trust should already be providing this service, and it's a bit unreasonable really that the CCG are going to fund it when South Tees really should have done already.
I'd actually agree with that, and the other thing that we had concerns about is that it wouldn't really be very helpful to our patients, because it's going in the opposite direction to where they're thinking to go to. We felt that there was certainly a local authority issue here as well, because public transport to South Tees, it's a bus, a train and a bus, and it's not very easy for people from certainly the Richmond area.
Yeah, I mean, I absolutely agree with that. I think all I'd say is that, you know, there is no new money coming from the local authority for transport. In fact, they're reducing transport to hospital as part of they've just done a consultation around that recently, and the number of bus services are going down rather than up. We have had those discussions, but I suppose I'm a pragmatist, and I just think, you know, the reality of it is that South Tees won't do it alone. They may do it in partnership with us, but they won't do it alone. So we either do it I think we as a sort of executive, having been to all the meetings, feel that actually this is responding to the issues for our public, and that actually that's, you know, part of our job. And although I agree it's not particularly value for money, I think that we have to be cognizant of the idea that if we don't fund this, we will be perceived as not listening to what our public is saying to us. So I mean, that's just my view. I don't know whether
it should be jointly funded, because if you pension end up pulling the service because it isn't viable, it will be the CCG pulling it, and I don't think that should be the case. I think you should fund it jointly.
It has come up at all of the public meetings, this issue about transport, and as in the other service provision as well. So I think I agree with Vicky here, it was us responding to the public's concerns about this. I don't know whether we should do it on the basis, as we've said, for the ambulance, virtually a 6-month trial.
In
the sense of Duncan's point, saying, I think then if we pulled it, would be because we said we'd do it for 6 months, and hasn't been utilised fully, then we tried it, and then from there we can make a decision.
I was just wondering if you had this regular bus service, would that take some of the pressure off the ambulance service for routine appointments? Could you get some money back from there to fund the bus?
I think trying to get money out of the ambulance contract would be, I mean, we always give it a go, and yeah, I think we'll have a go. I mean, I think, to be fair, we at the CCG have always said it should be jointly funded. We would never, want to fund it totally, and I had a discussion with Tricia Hart a couple of weeks ago about that, and she is going to look at it. And I think it needs to be a sort of senior decision, from the trust. I think the difficulty is that South Tees Trust have a lot of financial issues at the moment, and so for them to invest in something like this is difficult for them.
Charles?
I think if we looked at it in isolation as being purely for pediatric patients, it doesn't make sense. But if the number of transfers has now reached such a point that doing it for every speciality doesn't make sense, and it's been a huge part of the public response around the consultation of Fit for the Future of the events we've done so far, wanting to improve public transport, particularly to James Cook, and this would go a long way towards that.
Perhaps to deal with the point that Duncan was making, which I do agree with, that South Tees ought to be paying their share. Perhaps it should be made clear that they are not, so the public understand that.
Mark has just joined us from Danby.
Hello.
Just to update you, we've taken three votes so far. The votes have been on the decision not to consider the three options that have been submitted after the consultation from the public based on that don't fit the criteria. So there's an overall vote for yes not to do that. What would your view be on that?
So yeah, I would agree with that.
You would agree. The second vote was on the having a 7-day paediatric services, times to be confirmed, but 10 in the morning, 10 in the evening seemed to be the suggestion, and run that for 6 months. And then review it to see whether it was the best way to use that clinical time. So would you be in agreement with that?
Daytime.
Yes, seven days, but daytime, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. The third option we've voted on was around the ambulance service provision, and there was a discussion about having a dedicated service ambulance provision just for maternity services, or whether we should actually have a dedicated ambulance, but it would be linked to other services in Northallerton, but still be available for the transfer if need be from the maternity service at Friarage to James Cook. And the view was by a vote of 11 to 2 that we should have the dedicated ambulance provision but link it to a service, another service in the area.
Yeah, I haven't got a view on that.
You haven't got a view on that?
Okay.
Thank you. We're now discussing the shuttle bus issue. On the proposal to have a shuttle bus running from the Friarage on a regular basis, that would cover all of the services, not just paediatric maternity services, for visitors or families.
When you say regular basis, how regular is this going to be?
It's five journeys a day both ways.
Could I ask, are we supposed to be putting forward feedback as to what we feel our practice population would forward?
I think it's a decision as a CCG, so it's not directly for your practice. It's you as a commissioning member of the CCG. That's what the Council of Members is, in a way. For instance, we had a debate about the Whitby practices, whose populations don't have much to do with this at all, and yet their input into this as a commissioner is still important. So, in a way, it's you as a decision, us as a decision-making group for the CCG, not you as a representative of your practice.
And are we allowed, once we give the opinion, are we allowed to clarify why we've made that decision?
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other comments on the shuttle bus proposal before we actually take a vote on that?
I think as a practice we were under the impression it would be more frequently than five times a day.
You'd need two then, wouldn't you?
Pardon?
Sorry?
You'd need two shuttle buses
yes.
if it was going to be 5 times.
The practicalities of five a day is it'd be one bus going backwards and forwards, and you can manage that. If you go to more, you have to have two buses, and it doubles the cost, basically.
Yeah. I don't think we thought that through.
Transport business.
I just wonder how many staff members they have going backwards and forwards paying travel expenses for at the moment, and whether that could be
We have talked about that. The difficulty is that for their shift patterns, you'd need a bus to start very early in the morning, earlier than you'd need it for patients. So rather than starting at sort of, I don't know, 8:15, which would get people to the first outpatient appointment at 9, most of the nurses start their shifts at 7:30. So actually you'd have to have a bus at sort of 7:15, and that's a bus that we wouldn't actually necessarily need for patients. So I think it's about, I mean, I think those nuances are things we're thinking about, and what we said to them is if that would help them and not increase the cost hugely, then we would think about that. But we then just need to make sure that it fits in, because then the bus has got to get back, to pick people up, to get back for 9 o'clock. So it's just trying to make sure we fit all those things in. Mm-hmm.
And does it add a lot onto the distance if it goes via the A1 and the A66 and the A19 or some of the routes? Because you're only picking up a certain population at the moment and it's missing out a lot of people.
Hugely. It does increase the times a lot if you go the other way.
Okay, if there's no other comments on that proposal, can we vote on that proposal? The proposal is to have a shuttle bus running between Friarage and James Cook Hospital for patients, visitors, carers and staff. And we propose to run it for 6 months as a trial and then take a decision whether we continue or not.
With joint funding by the trust.
Yes, sorry, with joint funding by the trust. Okay, can we vote on
So it's between Friarage Hospital and
James Cook.
Two votes, one that it's joint funded and one that it's not joint funded.
Okay, so the first vote is the vote on joint funded shuttle bus running for 6 months. Who is in favour of that? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 11, 12, 13.
Yeah.
And the second vote is on the shuttle bus without the joint funding, so it would be just the
So who would fund that?
Just us.
No, South Tees.
Oh, so just South Tees.
I'm saying
South
Tees.
We need three votes.
I don't think they would completely fund it.
Well,
I think they would completely fund it. But we can vote on it if you want to.
Okay. The second vote is the shuttle bus would be funded by South Tees only.
Surprise.
I've got you when I
Two.
Does
anybody want to revisit the first vote?
I think we have to start from again.
Perhaps you do need to start again.
Because I thought
the
only funded by one party, that would be us.
Okay.
Okay. We're doing three votes now.
Yeah, three votes.
Well, we'll scrap the first two votes. It's going to be complicated.
I'm not sure you can vote on something when South Tees haven't put a proposition that they will even consider funding it. So I can't sure. Well, we might wish that, but I'm not sure that's relevant to vote on in this situation. Even if we like it, I just don't think you can vote on something which they haven't agreed.
I just bring another thing in. One of our partners particularly felt that it shouldn't be a free bus, that the people should contribute to it, and I think there would be quite a lot of uptake from people who can't find a parking space or claim they can't find a parking space, so routine outpatient trips I think would be picked up by this bus as well. So I think there's potentially quite a lot of people potentially using it, and should it all be free? Personally I'm happy it was free, but there were views expressed by some of my partners that it shouldn't be a free service.
Yes, I think like all these things, the detail has yet to be worked out. I think, I suppose, I'm just saying from my perspective, if we get a proposal to say that we, in principle, we support the idea of the shuttle bus running for 6 months, and then we have to go away and work out on some of the detail, would that be acceptable to people? Because I think the points being raised are all very valid. You know, some people might want to contribute to it, and that would help reduce the cost.
And I think we can take back to South Tees that there was a very strong feeling in the meeting that it should be funded by them. And I can certainly feed that back without the vote, I think. I think that's what I'm getting from people, that people actually think that actually South Tees should be playing a part, at least a part, and probably all are funding it. But that we won't vote on it because it's not a proposal. Is that reasonable? Yes. Everyone happy with that?
So just to clarify for the sake of the video, is that we have voted on the shuttle bus proposal, we've accepted the proposal. Based on the 6 months, but we accept that that's in principle we need to work on the details. Thank you.
Okay,
Okay.
Anybody else?
Okay.
Anybody else?
Thank
Okay, the next bit is about the taxi utilisation. This is a very small bit of work, but one of the feedbacks we got from patients was that there are a very small number of patients who are transported to James Cook out of hours. At the moment it happens mainly if you have a child with a surgical problem. And they get to James Cook, both parents in the ambulance, no car, and they are then discharged and they can't get home. So what we are suggesting is that we have a small taxi contract that brings those people home. Now, most people, one parent goes in the ambulance and the other follows in the car. Mm. So this, I don't expect this to be a big contract, but it's responding, it's us responding to anxieties expressed by parents. And we have had some sort of horror stories of parents being discharged from James Cook at 3 a.m. and not being able to get home. So it feels appropriate for us to offer that as in exceptional circumstances. We talked about whether we could do that in need, but my worry about that is trying to define need at 3 a.m. is a very difficult thing to do. So you can't make a valid judgment about somebody's economic position when they just been in the hospital with their poorly child, and I think it would be inappropriate to expect clinicians to ask them those questions. We don't expect it. I mean, I would be very surprised if this is the amount of money that we spend on it. I mean, it's a bit like, you know, when the minor injury unit happened at Harewood, initially we were given a taxi contract to send people from Harewood into the Friarage if they couldn't get their own transport. I think we used it twice and the contract was cancelled. So I think it's unlikely to be that, but it's responding to anxieties from the public, and those horror stories, you can understand why people felt traumatised by those incidents.
Comments?
Are we talking about restricting this just to paediatrics and maternity?
Yes.
Okay. Is that fair?
No. I mean, you can open it up if you want to.
What happens at the moment from another speciality if somebody's gone with a nosebleed? That's probably the thing that brings to mind most. Nosebleeds dealt with and they've got to get home. Do the trust not fund the ambulance for that?
No.
So any days gone by when we used to work in hospitals, that used to happen. I think the idea is reasonable, but it's also reasonable for other specialities as well.
Yeah, well, I'm happy, but I think, you know, the wider we make this, the more expensive it becomes, that's all. But I'm happy that we do that. That's the feeling of the meeting.
I would agree with the point Duncan's made. If we're going to have a shuttle bus that's open to others, then perhaps we ought to have the same principle for taxis.
That's fine.
I suppose we were in favour if the shuttle bus service was not satisfactory. So it was dependent on the shuttle bus service.
It will be different hours. I mean, I think the idea, this isn't about daytime. I mean, obviously, if you could go during the day, you'd get the shuttle bus back to Northallerton. Mm. But again, you know, Northallerton might not be where they've come from. I mean, you have to look at every option, wouldn't you? I mean, if someone's come from Catterick, getting a shuttle bus to Northallerton is not very helpful, really. Or if they come from Hawes.
What happens in other areas now when there's, you know, people go to a hospital that's a distance away from home? I mean, is there a funding taxi?
Yeah, there is in a lot of places, or they wait for a long time for ambulances. I mean, the difference is the distances are considerable, and I think the worry for us is that actually if an emergency ambulance is caught up transferring somebody back on a routine basis, that takes them out of the picture for the ambulance and actually just makes other things like our 8-minute response times worse, because that ambulance is caught up doing something else.
I think it's important, in my view, to limit it at the moment to really this population of paediatrics and maternity at the moment, because whilst it's probably desirable and in many ways a good thing to have taxis also for other patients, I think that's really a big project. And I can see that the taxis are a response to the anxieties created by the change in the paediatric and maternity service, and maybe for the time being limited to that, because I think there is a risk that it becomes a really huge and costly undertaking that people realise, oh, we can ask for a taxi, and probably desirable in many ways, but I think it can be a very big project.
I think we're going to go for another two voter here. we've had two main opinions expressed. The first vote then will be on the taxi service, but only for maternity and paediatric service users. So who would agree to that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 for that proposal.
So we'd have to review on that instance when we've got 9. We'd have to review the comments back on the
Yes, from the other practices.
All the others we've now got over 11.
So the second vote would be on whether we have it for the tax service, but for all specialties. And who would vote for that? It's 1, 2, 3. Thank you. Sorry.
I would just think for both of those votes, if that's to go through, if you're going to review the notes, I don't think you can review what the information that we've provided with the discussion that's had. I don't think the practices who aren't represented here can make a call on that.
I think that's, have to send them an update.
That's really tricky to make something be foolproof for somebody to say, yeah, it's all
right. So if we agree that what we'll do is send them the discussion notes from here and ask them to vote again?
I think we'd probably like to do that as well, because I don't think we've discussed that option as a practice.
Okay. We're the same, we haven't really specifically discussed this, so I don't really feel I can vote either way.
Okay. So can we agree then that with the bit about the taxi, what we will do is we will disregard the vote, we will send it out to you, we'll do a pro forma and ask you to vote about that in the practice with a time scale to get that back. We need it back quickly because it needs to go to the governing body. So is that reasonable?
Would you be putting costings as an estimate on the taxi for everybody? Because that could be a lot higher than us.
I don't think there's any way we could do that. I think we have no idea how many people it's literally that.
Okay, the agreement then is on the taxi vote, we disregard the vote we've just taken, and we will then send out to each of the practices a formal which is saying taxi, yes, and if it's yes only for maternity and paediatrics or for other specialties as well, so that will be the two questions.
Okay, the next one is the telemedicine pilot for open access families.
We discussed it in the practice, and we actually felt for £50,000 you could actually have another specialist community pediatric nurse in the community working with the patients all the time. And for the added benefit you got from having a telephone call with a consultant, it was probably not worth that £50,000. And that's what we actually feel it's worthwhile going ahead.
Yeah, we had similar views at Labour and felt that there just really wasn't the evidence there to support that kind of investment.
Okay, so the vote on this one is do you support the proposal for telemedicine open access families at a cost of £50,000 per annum? So, for people in favour of that, put their hands up. One. Okay, and for those against? Thank you very much.
So just going back to that then, do you want that funding then? Can you say you want funding transferred into nursing or just not put into
I think what we'll do for the sake of this meeting is we're just voting on the telemedicine issue, but what I mean the other issue, we'll pick that on part of the commission plan.
Can I ask a bit of a simple question, really? Mm-hmm. I mean, as far as I work out, we've just agreed about £650,000 extra money next year.
Yeah.
Is the funding available for that? We've not really talked about the funding position of the CCG, and I'm just a bit worried that we might throw us into a bit of a problem.
Okay, we're sorting out the funding for the CCG. I mean, the good news for us as a CCG is we're on track to balance financially this year, having paid back our debt.
So that puts us in a really strong position, and our contract with South Tees is on track. We're actually about £500,000 over our contract, but that is for one particular patient who was in ITU for a very long time, and if you take that out, we're actually just about on balance for our contract. The good news for that is that means going forward, we'll be setting a contract from that position, whereas in the past, year on year, what you ended up with is overtrading and your contract in your next position therefore started much higher than the previous position. Whereas we're not doing that, we're starting from a baseline of the contract we agreed for last year. So that puts us in a really good position going forward. Having had a quick look at the money, and you know, we're doing an enormous amount of work now about all the priorities, and we've got a lot to discuss with you. I mean, the things like IVF and Section 136, which is about a safe provision for people who have mental health problems when they're been arrested by the police. We're picking up a lot of things that actually the PCT didn't fund, but actually make us a real outlier. So we have a whole list of those criteria, those priorities too. We think that, I mean, we have put aside indicatively money for the Friarage issues, and we think we can make it balance, but obviously it will reduce other things that we could do. And I think there's a question for you as a GP community as to how much of that detail you want to get into and how much you want to leave that to the governing body and the CCG executive. But if you want to go through all the lines of the Better Care Fund and all the other investments and IVF and all those things, we're very happy to share that with you, but it is a big piece of work. What we feel at the moment, I think if Debbie was here, and she can't be here today because she's on annual leave, is that she would say that within the financial plans for the CCG, we have factored this in. The difficult bit is that if you do it through a sort of prioritisation criteria, this wouldn't necessarily come particularly high on the list. Mm-hmm. But neither would IVF or some of the other things that if you look at them simply from that criteria, they wouldn't necessarily pick up.
That's what I was going to say. I mean, you've obviously got a number of competing priorities.
Yes.
And that has to be all worked out. And this must have to come out near the top for us to agree all the funding without taking cognizance of all the other decisions around the other priorities you've mentioned.
Yep. I think at the moment, looking at the governance of it, I mean, I think because you, as a GP group, chose to make this decision, the other decisions are delegated to the governing body to make, and therefore it's the governing body's job to fit all these or your views into the framework for the future. So I suppose it's a job of the governing body to see how that fits with everything else. And I think when you've agreed these, if the recommendation from you as a group is that you would then delegate the responsibility to the governing body to find to prioritise these against other things, it then allows us to do the next bit of the job. If you didn't want to do that, and you either are telling us we have to do this as a governing body, or that you want to prioritise all the bits, either of those things are possible. As a council of members, you have the right to have any of these decisions made here rather than there.
Okay. A little voice, I think.
Okay, the next stage of process.
Third option is 7-day working, so it might be gained for the community with paediatric nursing combat.
Yeah, that's the only thing I missed out the extended additional community paediatric nursing. And I think that's because it got kind of stuff subsumed into the working out of the short stay assessment unit. And I think there's a obviously if we're going to fund that, it may be that we decide not to fund the community nursing at the weekend, because you could argue that it may actually end up doing the same job twice. Views?
I agree. If you find that the 7-day working isn't viable, then you need more community nursing at that stage. I don't know how many community paediatric nurses are there at the moment.
There are three.
just on that situation?
Well, we feel there's a lot of work to do actually around how the community nurses work and actually joining up the specialist nursing team from South Tees with the community paediatric team around the children's centre, and there's quite a lot of work that actually if they work more effectively together we get a better service, and we are doing that work anyway. So I suppose that the question is, if we find that the community, that the 7 day a week service in the hospital doesn't work, do you want us then to investigate? I'm getting the view from people that they don't want both. Is that fair enough? And for now, what we'll do is agree to the consultant-led short stay assessment unit rather than the paediatric nursing extension. Can we just vote on that?
Sorry, yes. So the based on the proposal which we've made earlier on to go for a 7 day consultant-led service, what we're saying is we're not going to pursue the extension of the community paediatric nursing establishment. So are people comfortable with that?
Yeah, I didn't know that was one of the options. Which option was that it?
Option one.
On the...
It says extension...
Nursing at weekends. So you'd have the nursing from 9 till 9, and then you'd have community nursing at the weekend.
So can we just sort of show of hands that we're agreeing that as we're pursuing this 7 day consultant led working, we are not going to pursue the, at the moment, the enhanced community psychiatric pediatric nursing service. Get it right. Does people vote on that issue? Yes.
Does it? Sorry, just to clarify, does it mean that there's still community cover with paediatric nursing throughout the week and weekend?
No.
No. So everybody will have to come into the hospital, because I think that was one of the issues on option three, that there was concern there was a lack of.
Yes, there was.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. But we're not taking any of the community paediatric nursing levels that currently are will remain.
Yes.
And then the enhancement will be the paediatric assessment unit, but that will cover 7 days, so the additional paediatric nursing for the weekends will go in. So that's what you're in effect by saying you want the paediatric assessment unit to work 7 days, you won't put weekend community paediatric nursing. But if that doesn't proceed, then we will review the community paediatric nursing at weekends to support local children.
I think it would be fair to say that although we have costings from South Tees around a 7 day service, they are not keen to put in a 7 day consultant service. And so what we will take back from here is an absolute requirement from GPs to deliver that, and we will negotiate as much as we can, but I can't guarantee that we can do that. Because there is a lot of anxiety from the paediatricians about how they would actually manage to get people to do those hours practically.
Okay.
Can we carry on?
Yes.
The next part is any questions or comments about any of the other options that we, options 3, 4, and 5. We've got a list of scores up there. So what we will do is just go through the ones that we haven't got, I think. Can people just confirm as we go down that those are the scores that they gave us? So that's labour and practice, Lambert, not here, Mayford. Boxers Lane.
Yep.
Central Dales.
Yep.
Topcliff.
Yep.
Harewood.
Yeah, I'm just doing my maths because I didn't have them.
We have it.
We have.
Is it right? Yes.
My father's had the school.
Thirst.
Great.
Egton, they're not here. Whitby. Okay. Reith,
are you here? Because I know a number of the practices said they bring their scores today.
Okay, so Reith haven't come?
Not here, but they are sending them through.
Okay, the Reith are not here, but they are sending them through. Leave house?
Yeah, I'm just doing my sums.
Okay, we'll come back to you.
54.
52, yeah. So
I'm doing Glebe House.
52.
Yeah.
Did you score option two?
That's my score for option one, and I'll do my score for option two now.
54, 44.
Option two was 45 for Glebe House.
45?
Yeah.
Okay, Great Ayton. Apologies. Do you have any feedback from them?
Again, waited.
We're waiting for their score. Mowbray.
Option 1, 44. Option 2, 36.
Quakers Lane.
Quaker Lane.
Awaited.
Right. Scorton?
We just wanted option one.
Okay. That. No score, but they will put vote for option one. Okay. The Friary?
The Friary emailed. The Friary emailed to say that they didn't have the time to fill the scores in, but they would go with a consensus of opinion.
So option one.
Well, it is because it's coming out. So Staves.
Staves. Given
there. No scoring.
To follow.
No scoring matrix, but preferred option one.
Okay. Sites.
We didn't come to a number, we prefer option one, and we'd be prepared to support the majority.
Danby?
I'm just making sums, but 45, 39, 41. I'm just doing the last two ones.
Go on, perhaps Sam will give you a moment.
To 35 and 30 for us.
35 and 30, so your preferred option is option 1. That's right.
Seemingly.
Yeah. Sorry, can you just give me those numbers again?
35
and
30.
35.
Okay, and if I could just ask, although I know they can't vote, the military practice?
Preferred option 1.
Preferred option 1, that's the practice from Catterick. Thank you for being here. Okay. Okay, well, I mean, I think that's fairly, I think we've agreed unanimously with the people who have voted to vote for option one. The next stages of this are that we now go to a governing body meeting on the 27th of February. That's a special meeting in Northallerton. We're expecting quite a lot of media coverage at that meeting. If any of you were able to come, that would be really good. And I think that we then understand that there's going to be an OBN scrutiny meeting of the local authority, and that will be on the 14th of March, and they will then make a decision regarding whether or not they decide to refer it back to the Secretary of State. If they don't, then the decision stands. And the South Tees would begin to implement that decision, and they reckon it would take them about 6 months, probably, to for it to be in place. If it is referred through, we don't know how long that will take. It will depend again whether there's a short review, as there was last time, or a longer review where they actually send a team out to do a visit and talk to stakeholders. It could take anywhere between 6 months and a year for that to happen. Obviously, our concerns about the longer process is that the service at the moment is very fragile. There are some real concerns, particularly around middle grade cover for obstetrics at the moment, which make the service very fragile. But we will obviously have to do our best to cope with that. I don't know whether anybody has any other comments or anything.
just going to say, from our discussion, our main worry came about the midwife-led maternity unit, because that wasn't an option for discussion, really. And within our practice, three of us have had cases where we've needed emergency for normal deliveries, and it's all gone wrong, and you need care within 2 or 3 minutes, not 45 minutes up the road. So I wonder if having a midwife-led unit in a hospital gives people the impression that emergency care will still be there, and of course it won't be there at all, and whether we should be considering moving all maternity care to James Cook.
I think, this is something that we've rehearsed in public quite a lot, and I think if you look at the national study which looked at thousands of births across the country, what it found was that actually delivering in a midwifery-led unit is safe, as safe as delivering anywhere. And we can send you that survey if you'd like to see that as evidence. What it is, and actually I think because I've been to so many meetings, I can rehearse this for you, because actually it's a midwife's answer. It's about assessing risk. And what they would say is that nobody will be booked for the midwifery-led unit who has any kind of high risk, and that they will be transferred the minute their labour changes in any sense. So if they're slow in stage one, they'd be transferred. And the idea, therefore, is that you're transferred when your risk changes, not when you have problems. And that most people who have problems have had a change of risk early on, but they're still managed within the unit because they have consultants there. So if you were delivering and it took you 25 hours to get to your second stage, that wouldn't happen in a midwifery-led unit, because it would be too long. And they would transfer you 4 hours in if you were clearly not progressing the way they're expecting you to. And the view of them is that actually, if you do that and you manage the risks right, it is safe. There will obviously always be those people where it suddenly goes wrong at the last minute, but that happens in a consultant-led unit and babies die there too. I mean, that's the really hard message about it. And actually, I think it's called the Place of Birth Study, but we can find it for you. That looked at 62,000 births, and what it said was there actually isn't a difference in safety. And there are, you could argue that in a consultant-led unit, sometimes you have a much more interfered with delivery, and that brings its own risks with that. So, I mean, that is the evidence. And what's interesting is that some units work really well and are very popular, and some don't. If you look at, there's a unit in Cumbria at Kendal where they have practically 500 deliveries a year. It's a very well used unit, people use it a lot. Other places they struggle to get numbers. I think the most important thing is that the midwives make sure they give patients a really informed choice. It's looking at the figures, it's unlikely that any primate would deliver at the Friarage, because that would already be considered to be too high a risk. I don't know whether other people have views about that, whether you want us to take any feedback from that. When we did the initial options back, what it was now, it was the GP feeling that we should include a midwifery-led unit in that. We did discuss not having a midwifery-led unit, and the feeling was that we should offer that in terms of local provision, which is why it was in both options originally.
I completely agree. I mean, it's properly evidence-based. Home births are safe if you choose the patients, and we can't medicalize normal processes of life. I mean, we can't everybody who has a baby put them into a university hospital just to have a baby. This approach is correct.
What we have said very clear to the public is that there are standards within the Royal College guidance about the number of deliveries you have to have in a midwifery-led unit for it to be safe. It's about 300 a year. Less than that is not considered safe in terms of training and keeping your skills up to date. So if people do, it's sort of use it or lose it, you know. And I think that will be true for the paediatric assessment unit also. Mm-hmm. If people don't choose it, then it wouldn't be acceptable to keep it going. So both of these services will be monitoring very carefully.
Is there any other business? If not, thank you all very much for your participation. And like I said, the recommendation will now go forward to the governing body meeting on the 27th. Thank you.
Yeah.